at home from Holy Trinity Church. It is lovely to be able to be in church and to be back from our short break. We hope that you enjoyed visiting some other churches over the last 2 weeks. We have moved back into church because we're trying to move towards what is called, rather excitingly, hybrid church, which is where we can have services that are attended for people online and also physically in church. Some of that's going to need a bit of work on the sound system and on getting cameras and Wi-Fi and all of that kind of stuff. So we're experimenting with what we have at the moment and then hopefully getting moving towards all of the tech that we need in here. So do give your feedback on what works and what doesn't work over this service and the service next week. It is lovely to have Paul and Alison in church with me this morning. Paul will be preaching, and his theme today is going to be reflecting on that question from Jesus in our gospel today. Who do you say I am? Let's pray together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We say together,
Lord God, we set this time apart for you. By the presence of your Spirit, fill our worship, hear our prayers, speak to us and change us. Form us into the likeness of Jesus Christ, so that our lives may glorify you. Amen.
So our first hymn today is Praise to the Holiest in the Height. Say together, Most merciful
God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So our first Bible reading this morning is Psalm 67, read by John Hayes.
The lesson is taken from Psalm 67. God be merciful unto us, and bless us, and cause his face to shine upon us, that thy way may be known upon earth, thy saving help among all nations. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. O let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for thou shalt judge the people righteously, and govern the nations upon earth. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. Then shall the earth yield her increase, and God, even our own God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, and all the ends of the world of the earth shall fear him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dwelling in the Word this morning on the Matthew reading. So you'll need to have Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 13, open in your pew Bibles, ready for us to dwell in the Word. Just in case you are new with us this morning, dwelling in the Word, we hear the passage read twice, and I just invite you to see what you notice. Do you have a question? Does a phrase or a statement jump out at you? Do you find something interesting? And we'll have an opportunity to share that with each other after we've heard the passage read twice. Alison, thank you.
The reading is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, from verse 13 to 20. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the what you notice. If you are at home with others, please speak to each other and share what you've noticed. Write in the comments. If you're at home on your own, please write in the comments and then we'll be able to share together what we have learned from the passage this morning before Paul speaks to us.
Rachel, what did you notice?
You noticed in the passage. We had a few things here that we noticed. Alison, do you want to say what you noticed?
I noticed that there were a lot of words of you mentioned through the passage, and so Jesus is really asking us personally, who do we ourselves really think in our hearts who Jesus is?
So that you is to us, and it almost sort of pierces us in our response,
yes.
In a sense. Lovely, that word you. That really resonated for me as well. I always find that very powerful. Roisin, what did you notice?
I noticed that, like, at the end of the passage, or near the end, it talked about how he said that he didn't want them to tell people that he was Jesus Christ. And then it's sort of like, because obviously it's known for people trying to tell everyone about Jesus Christ, but at that time, he didn't want anyone to know that he was Jesus Christ.
So you were puzzled by the fact that in verse 20 he said, then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. But actually, we are called to tell people about Jesus, aren't we, and the good news. So that's quite interesting. I wonder whether Paul might talk a little bit about that when we come to it. But we do know also, don't we, that at that time there were a lot of people who were trying to harm Jesus. So he was quite careful with his disciples about that risk at that point. And then obviously later he said, please tell everybody about me and the good news. So lovely. Mia, what did you notice?
I noticed that that Jesus was, proud that all the things he said have been put to good use by the fact that his people are learning that, you don't, gossip isn't the thing to say who's who, but you just know in your heart who it is.
By that, blessed are you, Simon. Yeah. Weren't you really pleased that Jesus was saying, well done, Simon, because you know who you are. Brilliant. Thank you. What comments have we got?
Ogwin said, Peter recognised that Jesus was divine, the Son of God.
Yeah, absolutely. And, thank you, Owen.
I think this is from here. But Jeanine said, who Jesus is revealed by my Father in heaven, not by man.
Interesting that, isn't it? So it's the God's Spirit, the Spirit of the Father, reveals God to us. That's really interesting, isn't it? Lovely. Thank you so much, everybody, for those comments on what you've noticed. I'm now going to invite Paul to come and preach for us.
Thank you.
So Baptist, for John was held in very high esteem. Others say Elijah, who was expected to return. And still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets, no doubt thinking of the likes of Moses. These were the religious elite and revered figures in first century Judaism. But turning to his disciples in verse 15, Jesus made the question much more personal. But what about you? Who do you say I am? Peter, no doubt, answering both for himself and for the other disciples, replies, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, Christ is Greek for the Hebrew word Messiah, and both words mean the anointed one. In Judaism, it meant the one who would bring hope and fulfill the hopes of the nation. Traditionally, three sorts of people have been anointed with oil: prophets, priests, and kings. And Jesus, in fact, did fulfill the expectations of all these three roles. Like the priest, but only perfectly, he puts people in touch with God. Like the prophet, but only perfectly, he showed people what God was like. And like the king, again, only perfectly, he exercised God's rule over God's people while himself being uniquely the servant of the Lord. It is a remarkable insight on the part of Peter coming to recognize who this carpenter teacher really is. No category of human exaltation can embrace him. Jesus surpasses them all. Peter here is the spokesman for the conclusion to which he and his disciples had been driven by all they had experienced. Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Going far beyond the populace, who gave a high place to Jesus and recognized him as one of the figures associated with the end time, Peter acclaims Jesus as God's final self-disclosure. In the words of the late Michael Green, here was the fulfillment of 2 Samuel 7 verse 13, predicting one who would establish David's throne forever. Here was the fulfillment of Psalm 2 verse 7, the king who really was the Son of God. There were no higher titles than these. Following Peter's confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus commissions Peter. The name Peter means rock, and whilst he was more usually called Simon Peter, it is the meaning of his second name that Jesus picks up on. Peter, the rock, was to be the rock upon which Jesus will build his church. But the rock is not just Peter, however, but Peter in his confessional capacity. Peter, full of trust in the Son of God, is the one who will become the rock man for the early church. And he did just that, as the early chapters of the book of Acts reveal. It was Peter who preaches the first evangelistic sermon, and it was Peter who paid the ultimate price for his devotion to his Lord. The result of Peter's confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, is that Jesus had found in Peter a real believer, and on that foundation, he could build his church. A church that could never be extinguished by the gates of Hades, because the risen Christ was to be head of his church, sustaining it and in communion with it forever. Furthermore, Peter was given authority in verse 19 by being given the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And also, whatever he bound on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever he loosed on derived from rabbinic usage. It meant to allow or disallow conduct based on interpreting the Torah. The Jewish law contained primarily the first five books of the Old Testament. Jesus, as the Son of the living God, is the true interpretation of the Torah, and will pass on that interpretation and also extend it. Peter has just confessed Jesus as the Son of God, the Messiah, greater than even the Torah, and to him is given the responsibility of interpreting to others the person and teaching of Jesus. He and the other disciples were to be authorized interpreters of Jesus to succeeding generations of the church. The power of the keys of the kingdom of heaven entrusted to Peter means that Peter, along with the other disciples, can make access to the kingdom of God available or unavailable through their witness and preaching. They can admit people into the kingdom or exclude them. This is not intended to be arbitrary action on the part of Peter or anyone else. Jesus is sending out his disciples for world mission. He is equipping them with his Spirit. They go in his name as his representatives and are naturally bound by the terms of their commission. So if people respond to the conditions of the gospel and repent and believe, then they can be confidently assured that God has indeed forgiven them. Jesus made that very clear. If they refuse those conditions, their sins are not forgiven by God. Jesus made that very clear too. And of course, we read in the Acts of the Apostles that the Apostles did just that. They confidently announced God's forgiveness to all the penitent believers on the day of Pentecost and thereafter. Equally, they remind the magician Simon Magus that he is still in the prison of sin and has not yet met the Saviour. His sins are not forgiven, and that is the proper exercise of the power of the keys of the kingdom of heaven. In conclusion, the question all of us face is not so much Jesus' first question, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" but rather the much more personal question, "But what about you? Who do you say Jesus is?" God has revealed himself to us through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and draws us to himself through the work of the Holy Spirit. This is a divine work which calls us to repentance and belief, starting with the confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And as Jesus says to Peter in verse 17, "This was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." There will be many listening today who confidently confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. But there may be some for whom it is not so clear cut. Maybe you are one of these. Maybe you are exploring the Christian faith and are somewhat mystified by who Jesus really is. Maybe you used to be a follower of Jesus, but have lost touch with him in recent years. Or maybe you are going through difficult times and are wondering whether there really is a God to whom we can relate. If you're one of these, maybe you'd like to consider joining one of the many groups that meet, admittedly by Zoom in these COVID-19 times, to explore Christian faith. Holy Trinity has groups that meet during the day, for example on Thursday mornings, evening house groups, and in the autumn, CASA will be running a special course for those who would like to explore the Christian faith, whether from a position of belief or unbelief. If you're interested, please contact CASA. confidently respond in the words of Peter, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Amen.
Amen.
We're now going to sing the Tese song, "In the Lord I'll Be Ever Thankful."
We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts by faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So we come to our intercessions, our prayers for the world, the church, and each other. These beautiful reflections have been written by Ruth Baden, and she's asked me to read them for her this morning. Let's pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. We bring to you, Lord, the Church in all its richness and its need, all its diversity and its divisions. Give us a fresh understanding of what it means to live in you, and may we all, both laity and clergy together, celebrate the reality of your presence among us, filling us with new life and fresh hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world and its people, remembering all those places where there is conflict, misery and want, and where people's hopes and dreams have been crushed. We think particularly of Lebanon and Syria, the people of Beirut, and refugees far from home. We pray for the work of a Bella Boys Home in India, our charity of the month. We pray for our own country and our struggles with COVID-19, and we ask humbly for your healing touch. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you wholeheartedly for all your blessings. May we never take them for granted. Teach us to be awake to your prompting, however unlikely it may seem, and help us to respond and to walk in faith with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the sick, and we name Marie, Alistair, and Sienna. And we pray for those who mourn, thinking of the families of Christine, Margaret, Louisa, and Donald. And in a moment of quiet, we bring before the Lord those who are particularly on our hearts at this time. Lord, bring healing and comfort and a real sense of your presence. Merciful Father, accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
So we come to the peace. God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you. Wonderful. So we come to our time of reflection for our offering. As a community, each week we gather and we reflect on what we can offer to God in the week that is to come. What of our resources, both of our time and our skills and our financial resources, are we going to offer to God this week? Let's just take a moment to reflect on that. So we make our offering to God. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything on heaven and earth is yours.
All things come from you, His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, you made the world and you love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed
is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you and gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day, when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. We say together the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Lamb of Jesus,
Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace.
So we pray together our prayer for spiritual communion. Thanks
be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen.
The body of Christ. Amen. we give thanks in words of this prayer. Father
of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
So we come to our notices. I'll just get my notebook so I don't forget anything. Wonderful. So we have our 5 o'clock physical service in church today. And next week, the 5 o'clock service will be a communion service. And indeed, all the 5 o'clock services in September will be communion services. So if you'd like to come to one of those, please do get in touch with Jane to book your place, because obviously we need to book people into the bubbles that we have and keep people physically distanced in the church. So I talked a little bit at the beginning of the service about hybrid church, the idea of having online and physical church. As you have seen this morning, things can go slightly pear-shaped because of the equipment. If you were able to see this side of church, you would see all sorts of wires and cables going all over the place in order to have the screen, and the difficulty at the moment with the sound is that it's coming through the normal speakers rather than being plugged into the system, which is why we've got the table here, which means I'm not too far away, because if I was right up at our beautiful high altar, then you probably wouldn't be able to hear me. So the PCC is working on this at the moment. They've been absolutely brilliant. We're getting quotes to put Wi-Fi into the church and quotes for all the technical stuff. So a camera which will go up high so that you can see the church from the front, and then the sound system that will plug directly into the online service information. But will also benefit anybody who's going to be in the church physically as well. So part of that will be that we'll be having a gift month in October, specifically for this project, which we hope people will feel able to give to. Any gift is very much appreciated and will all go to help to pay for the equipment that we need to go towards hybrid church. If you've got any questions about the hybrid church, please come and speak to me. If you've got any questions about making a donation, please speak to Audrey and she'll be able to help you with that. I mentioned earlier on, I think that our charity this month is the Abella Boys Home in India. You may already have been able to make a donation to that, but if you did what I did earlier on this week, was to go onto their website and look for the donate button and realise it's not there, you've got to fill in the form. So what I've done instead is I've made a donation online to Holy Trinity and put in the reference August Charity, and I'll follow that up with an email to Audrey. So if you're thinking how am I going to do this, that may be a way of doing it. But you can also always put a donation either through my door or through Audrey's door, and checks can be made to that as well if you wanted to. Finally, I've done some resources, retreat at home resources, which we're now on to the fourth week. If you haven't managed to use any of those, they are available anytime on the Facebook page, and also if you'd like a paper copy, just let Jane know, and you can use them in September if you wanted to. Wonderful. Those are all the notices that I had. We are now going to sing our final hymn, In Christ Alone.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song.
this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm.
Truth and peace. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father.